Great. It is so wonderful to follow Dr. Akil and be with all these great people that are so energized about health and wellness. We talked about how technology can be a barrier to good health, but we're victims of it, right? It's going to be in our pocket. My phone is a bigger part of me than my own appendix. It's an organ, basically, in my body right now. So I've kind of accepted the fact that if I can't, I need to fight fire with fire. I've got to find a way to use technology to be an ally. So I want to teach you some ways that are going to really go on the principles that Dr. Akil talked about, where you can actually use technology tools to maybe help you improve your health. One of the problems with writing a book on health is everybody expects or has this expectation that you do everything right every day. You eat the right foods, and I want to just confess that that's not the case. I kind of look at my life as being a bit of a pendulum. So on one side, I've got my personal responsibilities, which is my own individual wellness. I've got my family responsibilities. And then on the other side, I've got my professional. I've got a very busy day job, but I think all of us might have a hobby job too. That might be charity. Maybe it's a company you're trying to start, an app you're developing, a book you're trying to write, a blog you're trying to start. So often I feel like I'm in about 20 different pieces trying to manage all these different elements, and I'm always trying to find that center. And really, that's where technology comes in, because often I am so stuck on one side. I'm immersed with a work project. Maybe there's something going on with a family situation or an ill family member. And sometimes I need some sort of tool. Hopefully it's a non-tech tool like meditation or practice you have, but there are some apps and devices and tools that I prescribe in the office in my clinic that will help people find their center again. So we're going to go through some of this. So to kind of highlight why we have this situation, so the book I wrote, even though it's called The South Asian Health Solution, what it really does do is it kind of examines our culture and our life from before and compare it to today. So this is sort of an example, because I get a lot of Asians in my clinic complaining, are you taking rice away from me? Are you telling me I can't eat rice? And I'm like, no, I'm not taking your starches away from you, but I want to highlight the point that I actually measure walking steps like a vital sign, just like blood pressure in the office. And I know from doing corporate wellness programs that my average engineer walks about 2,000 steps a day, 2,000 to 2,500. A rickshaw puller, and I'm obsessed with rickshaws, by the way, because I used to go to Calcutta every summer, and I would just sit in our house watching people pulling the human-pulled rickshaws. They're now auto rickshaws now. But this rickshaw puller pulls about 40,000 steps, so he's walking about 20 times more steps as a sedentary office engineer or any sedentary worker. Unfortunately, obesity is skyrocketing in Asia and India, so this guy has to have a very strong leg and core to pull around overweight families all day. So his legs and all his muscles are very strong, but we're sitting all day and our legs are atrophying, developing a weak leg and core for a lot of the reasons that Akil talked about. Now, what about vitamin D? So vitamin D is often associated with bone health, but now we know that vitamin D is really a hormone. It comes predominantly from the sun, and it helps counter inflammation in our body, which, as Akil explained, is a root cause for most chronic health conditions. So somebody who's pulling rickshaws and their skin is fairly exposed is going to have normal vitamin D levels, but when we're sheltered indoors and we're exposed to screen light instead of sunlight, vitamin D deficiency is going to be a major factor. And we see connections between vitamin D deficiency and all types of chronic health conditions. As much as we've been sort of taught to be sun phobic because of skin cancer risk, vitamin D deficiency is now powerfully linked to colon cancer, lung cancer, and other types of solid cancer. So I think the pendulum's gone the other way in terms of our phobia and risks about the sun. Lots of rice, lots of starches are okay for a guy pulling rickshaws like this, right? So that's where, you know, Akil's concept about tailoring the diet is really critical. Not everybody's going to be low carb. If you're this physically active, I have a couple of Olympic level athletes in my practice, and I'm not going to sit there counting their carbs. As long as they're high quality starches, they're okay. But if we're leading this sort of lifestyle, then we do have to look at certain macronutrients in the diet and tailor it accordingly. Okay? So let's talk a little bit about exercise and some of the tools that I use. So I want to ask you guys, what is the most challenging exercise to prescribe in my typical Silicon Valley individuals, the type A's? Almost, okay? So I'm going to tell you from my experience, it's interesting. If I practice in a different part of the country, getting people to move would be my biggest challenge. But I'm often encountering very type A Silicon Valley types that are moving quite a bit, and I'm just actually trying to get them to walk more often. They're already going to boot camps. They're doing all types of burpees. They're doing everything in terms of high intensity. But they've actually forgotten the power of walking. And I actually didn't appreciate this. I used to be that boot camper, 4 or 5 days a week, high-intensity workouts. And I was like, walking, that's for old people, okay? But when you look at the metabolic studies and the power of what walking does to your body, It has to be the foundation of your program. So when I see patients in the clinic, the first question I ask them is, how many steps are they walking? And the reason for that is walking isn't not only energizing, but it is a type of exercise that lowers inflammation in the body. When you're doing chronic high-intensity exercise, that's an inflammatory state. And if you're not resting, you have chronic cumulative inflammation. So walking is a wonderful way to lower inflammation. It spares the adrenal glands and the sympathetic nervous system, the SNS. When you're doing chronic high intensity and not resting, you're depleting your energy reserves and you're activating the sympathetic system on a regular basis. There are syndromes of high endurance chronic cardio athletes that are developing accelerated atherosclerosis. I've had some patients that have had a heart attack from doing too much cardio. So absolutely, you have to have time to rest. Elite athletes spend a lot of time resting. I've worked with triathletes and professional athletes. A professional marathon or triathlete gets about 10 to 12 hours of rest per night, which is about half of what most of us are getting, yet we're still trying to implement really rigorous exercise protocols. The other thing about walking is it spares hunger and injury, right? So when people are doing really high intensity exercises, often their hunger is a big issue, but you know, walking doesn't usually trigger intense hunger. So that's the other thing. And then of course, it's been around a lot longer than burpees, right? My grandmother lived to be 86. She's never done a burpee or push-up. Walking's been her fundamental activity, and really that's what we need to aim towards. So please make that the foundation of your exercise. So most of you are probably wearing maybe a Fitbit or an activity monitor. And you know, the one key thing I want to make, I know you've seen in the popular press, 8 to 10,000 steps, but really what I want you to be mindful of is how regularly are you getting that activity. When you do sit for more than 30 minutes at a time, your body produces a hormone called lipoprotein lipase that promotes high triglycerides and more fat storage. So now what I'm really tracking is how regularly are we active. So a couple things I recommend is a newer generation Fitbits. I have an older generation, but it checks your hourly steps. Same with the Apple Watch. But even if you don't do that, I often ask my patients, check your steps around 12 or 1 p.m. and make sure you've got about 4,000. Because I don't want you to just get your 8 to 10,000 in the evening or the morning and then use that as an excuse to sit all day because of the effects of prolonged sitting. So really use these tools to your advantage and really keep track of your steps at least once or twice throughout the day. This really does make a big difference for glucose control and lipid control and just overall health. Okay, so now let's talk about resistance training. So it's bad enough that he's got to cart somebody around, but this happened to me. So one summer I spent in Calcutta, and I was supposed to go to my uncle's wedding, and there was monsoon flood rains, and there was no transportation available except a human-pulled rickshaw. So I got on a rickshaw, and a guy waist-high in water carried me and my family about 3 miles across town to get to the wedding. This is the ultimate form of resistance training, obviously. So let's talk a little bit about resistance training here. So this is something I know a lot of us, I think gyms are great environments. They keep you motivated, but some of us don't have time. You travel on business. You want to get home to be with the kids. So one set of apps I use with my patients is by a company called Runtastic, and these are motion sensing apps. So whenever you have limited time, you want to make sure you engage as many large muscle groups as possible. So I typically prescribe the Runtastic squats, the push-ups, and the pull-ups. The squat app's pretty cool. You download the app, you have the phone in your hand, and you start squatting. It'll count how many squats you do. I tell my patients to do that maybe 2 or 3 times a week. The push-up app's cool. You put the phone on the ground. You do push-ups over the phone itself. It's got a sensor on it. It'll keep track of how many you're doing. And literally, I've done this. And the pull-up one, you put the phone in your pocket. It's got a vertical sensor. It'll count how many pull-ups you're doing. So my patients, I actually track this like a vital sign. The ones that are, we have a lot of patients in our clinic that are what we call skinny fat. A lot of Asians are very slender. They don't have much muscle mass, but they've got a little bit of a pot belly. And that's a dangerous recipe for early insulin resistance, diabetes, and heart disease. So one of my goals is, aside from trying to trim this down, is I want to add more strength and muscle to their extremities. So I literally want to have them come back. I want to see their squat tallies. I want to see if they're doing their squats. I want to see how their push-ups are doing, and they see their metabolic numbers improve. This just takes a few minutes. You can do it in a hotel room, but really you don't need equipment. You just need your own body. You know, if you're overweight, you've got more weight to pull, right? So as we lose that weight, it'll get lighter. So then you can add a kettlebell or some light dumbbells to enhance that workout. But this is really key. So another type of exercise that I really recommend everyone learns is how to lift, okay? So a rickshaw puller has to do several lifts every time he loads a passenger. But a deadlift, and I know deadlifts look very intimidating when you watch people lifting Olympic power, power weights, But really, the process is just, this is an exercise in where in one single movement, you're engaging all of your major muscle groups. And studies have shown that after 10 to 12 lifts, basically, the amount of growth hormone and testosterone that's released can really enhance fat burning and really optimize health. And it's a natural activity, because, you know, how many times do you do a push-up type motion in your real life? But you're lifting suitcases, you're lifting, you know, grocery bags. And the other thing about this that's nice is Akhil showed you that picture of the hunched forward movement. When you're doing lifts like this with dumbbells or with weights, you're enhancing their posterior chain. It's keeping your posture more upright. So very simple thing. You can do this at home with dumbbells, with grocery bags, with sacks of rice, whatever. But really learn to lift, because this is a real key thing to do. Okay, so Tabata, just to talk about this a little bit more, I recommend all my patients download a Tabata app. So Tabata is one of many techniques for high intensity interval training, and this one involves a cycle of doing 20 seconds of fast intensity and 10 seconds of stopping. So pick an exercise that you can do. Get on a spin bug, on a spin bike, maybe jump rope, and go 20 seconds hard, and then you stop for 10 seconds, and you do 8 cycles of that. That's just 4 minutes. And in 4 minutes, you get the metabolic benefits of doing 15 to 20 minutes on a treadmill at steady state. So if you've got very limited time, some mornings are hectic and chaotic, I'll get on a bike or I'll jump rope and I'll do 20 seconds, 10 seconds, I'll do 2 or 3 sets of that. And this has a different type of benefit than chronic cardio, because your body does produce more growth hormone, more testosterone, your body's actually liberating more fat. Now, one thing I do want to make the point about is don't use these techniques to get you back into the office to sit in front of the computer for longer. Because now there's a lot of articles about shorter workouts, but my fear is that people are using shorter workouts as an excuse to get back to work and sit more. This is one technique, but hopefully it's going to open up more time for you to do the yoga or get the walking steps in. It is time efficient if you're on business, but really make sure that you're enhancing other parts of your workout regimen. So this is a picture of me. So when I wrote my book, I wrote more than half my book on an elliptical machine, because I was like, if I write a book on health and then I gain a pot belly and I walk around trying to promote my book, that's not going to be good for me. So I literally set up a laptop on my elliptical machine. I used some resistance bands to strap it to the console, and I typed away on that for hours at a time. There would be sessions where I'd do 20, 30,000 steps a day just typing and typing on that thing. And believe me, I think I was more productive doing it that way, because when I sit and type or read, I get tired very quickly. I'm much less productive. And those are my kids doing some exercises there on the side, so we're able to sort of bond while doing that. And you know, a lot of the things that Akhil talked about, the standing treadmill is great. As a doctor in my exam room, I've already got an elevated standing desk, so I do all my charting there. I often will, because our hips get so tight, often when I'm charting, I might open, you can't see me now, but I often sit like this to open up my hips. Sometimes I'm in a semi-squatting position. You can do a lot of things to keep your muscles engaged, and you'll find that you're going to be less sore, and you're going to be feeling much better at the end of the day. You're not going to come home and just flop down on the couch. So really find ways to weave your work in your workouts together, so it's not just one thing or the other. Okay? So what is the most important part of an exercise regimen that my typical Silicon Valley types neglect? Stretching is a good guess. Sleep. Okay, that's good. Sleep is close enough. I'll take that. It really is true that it is rest, okay? And I didn't appreciate this because I was kind of a type A workout-aholic. But the thing is, if you're going to work out really hard, you need, the growth really happens during the rest intervals. After that intense workout, your body needs several days to recover. That is when it repairs tissue. That's when it actually grows muscles. So one of the things I tell people is when you are, you know, one thing is I ask them, how do you know when your next workout is? So a couple things is when you have little to no soreness. The game isn't to be sore every single day. I know some trainers might push that. You gotta feel like you're being tortured every day. But really, when you're at the point where you have little to no soreness, that's probably a good time. So when I do an intense workout, I spend the rest of the days with a foam roller, maybe a lacrosse ball to work out those tight muscles so I can recover quicker. When mobility is restored, so hopefully you're doing some stretching in your in-between rest days to really keep that mobility in shape. We're going to talk about HRV in a second, which is heart rate variability, and I really want people to start erring on the side of overresting. So when my patients say that they feel like they're ready to work out, I say wait 1 or 2 more days, and that's when you're ready to work out. And a big lesson to me on this was my kids run cross country, okay? So they're very avid runners. They've got like a training regimen that they follow. So one of my kids actually got sick with like a viral infection, and he stopped running for about 7 days, you know? And we're like, oh my God, this is going to be terrible. He's been running, whatever. So he literally went about 10 days before he ran again, and he ran his best mile ever. It was like the best race he'd ever run. And it just gives you the idea that this overtraining and not resting properly, it really prevents us from making progress with performance, but with overall health as well. So really, this is good news for us, because really resting more in between workouts should be a way for you to save some time as well. So I mentioned HRV. So heart rate variability is a really interesting biofeedback technique that I want you to be aware of. So when we think about our heart rate, often we think it's metronomic. It beats like this, tap, 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 tap with regular intervals. But there's actually natural variability built into the intervals between our heartbeats. And that's actually a good thing. So when you have more variability between your heartbeats, that's a sign that your parasympathetic system is actually in check. That's what we want. And I tell people variety is the spice of life, so your heartbeat should have variability in it. So there are a lot of tools out there. For a lot of world-class athletes, they use HRV to actually decide whether they should train or not. And this used to be very expensive to actually get HRV data, but now there are devices, there's apps that you can use. This is a display from Sweetbeat. And literally when you get up, if your HRV display shows that you've got low heart rate variability, that should be a rest or a stretch day, not a day to do heavy lifts or intense workouts. And you'll be surprised, most people actually intuitively don't know when they're supposed to rest, because we're so used to being sore and in pain and being in an accelerated mode. So for many of my patients that have used this, it's really allowed them to be more intuitive about when to rest. You can't be regimented where every Monday I'm going to go to boot camp. What if Sunday you didn't sleep well? What if you wake up really tired? That is not a good day to do boot camp. It's just going to accelerate inflammation and injury risk. And sometimes HRV can give you some really meaningful data. Okay, so I kind of call this syndrome chronic entrepreneur syndrome, because I started seeing a lot of CEOs in my office in Los Altos. I do a lot of consults there, and I started seeing a phenomenon where I'm seeing more patients and more individuals that are type A driven, body composition's great, lab numbers are great, but they're coming in with early atherosclerosis. I've had a few tragic heart attacks in patients. If you look at their numbers, you're like, what the heck is going on? Everything looks normal. So what's happening is these body types are typically, they're normal to fit. Labs might be mildly abnormal or completely normal. Their work output, I mean, they're highly successful. They're building billion-dollar companies, so they're obviously productive. Their fitness, they're at a very high level. They can do burpees, boot camps, all that stuff. Their stress levels are very high, but hyperactive has become normal for them. When they don't feel that rush in energy, they feel like it's not normal. So that adrenergic stimulation has become a normal part of their life. And their sleep, why would they need more sleep? They've been successful for so many years, right? So this is sort of the syndrome, that hyper-stimulatory effect that we've gotten used to, that promotes chronic inflammation, hormonal fatigue, and atherosclerosis as well. So I want you to really be aware of that, because as much as we're into quantifying ourselves and using tools and labs, often those don't tell the full story. So after seeing a few of these in my clinic, that's really motivated me to really slow my life down a lot more and find those spaces in between busy periods. Okay? So another cool app for vitamin D. So one thing that I really recommend is, for vitamin D, unfortunately, the recommendations are not very personalized. How our body utilizes vitamin D varies depending on a bunch of different factors. So this is one app that I've used to motivate people to get out into the sun. And the cool thing is, when you download the app, you actually put the inputs that could actually influence your vitamin D level. So you put in your location, right? Because it's very different being in California versus in northern latitudes. Your skin type, you put in your weight and BMI, you put in your last vitamin D level if you had one, and if you're taking a supplement dose, you put that in, and then you sit outside, and in real time, it'll tell you how many units of vitamin D you're getting while you're sunbathing. It's kind of a cool tool, but it does make the point that we can't just give generic advice, everyone should be out in the sun for 20 minutes or take this dose. It actually inputs the data that can influence that, so it's kind of a cool tool I've used for people to motivate really more sunlight exposure. Okay. So back to stress. So a couple of tools. I think one of the big problems with stress is we don't have a simple blood test for it. It's kind of a black box. But this is where technology is really helping, because we can use some simple tools to help us. So one thing is, I know it's kind of a blunt tool, but heart rate, I think, for most people is a decent barometer. So what I mean by that is, I know my very calm Zen heart rate is about 60, below 65. And often sometimes when I'm running at high speed, the simple way to check your pulse is the old-fashioned way. But your phone with the flash sensor, you can check your heart rate, you can use an app and sort of see where your heart rate is. I kind of put a disclaimer here, because when I taught some of my friends how to do this, they start like emailing me saying, why is my heart rate 20 points above my average now? So you can get into a lot of trouble if you recommend this, but it is good to know sort of what your baseline Zen heart rate is. Regulating your breath, this is something that is so critical, right? So your vagus nerves runs into your diaphragm. That is a flip switch for your parasympathetic system. The more things we can do to engage our diaphragm, the more we're going to switch on the parasympathetic system. Many of my patients that run around, they don't know how to send a breath into their belly. They breathe up here the whole time. When I ask them to send a breath to their belly, it feels very unnatural. Many of my patients that see me, they think they're having asthma or some sort of breathing issue. They've just lost the ability to naturally breathe. So this particular app, which I'll show on the next screen, gives you some cues to kind of teach you how to regulate that breathing. Dr. Akhil had a technique up there called pranayama. This is sort of the pranayama type diaphragmatic belly breathing to really activate that system. Now, heart rate variability I'm bringing back in here again, because aside from high performance athletes, you can use apps on your phone that actually measure HRV. So this is one that I use. It's called Instant Heart Rate. It's by a company called Azumio. It's not as accurate as some of the devices out there, but what it does is you put your finger on the flash sensor, and it'll measure your HRV, and when you're in the right zone, it actually gives you yin-yang points, so you actually get some feedback from that. It works well for me, but when I actually prescribe this to type A individuals, it often backfires, because the minute they start looking at their phone, they're like, why am I not getting a point? What's going on here? The minute you start judging your behavior and you start becoming type A, you are not going to get the yin-yang points. You have to look away, close your eyes, and it's kind of a lesson that a lot of us will fail this if we kind of drop back into our Silicon Valley mode. But again, it's another cool tool to use to help get some biofeedback on stress levels, okay? And this is a pranayama app. You can use any background on it. This is something I've used with the kids. So you basically breathe slowly. You can adjust the sound cues, the background music, but it's a wonderful tool to really teach the family how to breathe again. It's actually something the kids are forgetting how to do because they're overwhelmed with so much stress. So I really recommend this be something you teach everyone in your family. Okay? Another thing I've been using over the last year is something called binaural beats. Okay? And the whole concept of this is basically binaural beats. When you put your headphones on and listen to binaural beats or BNBs, what it does is it sends two different auditory tones into your ear. And the difference between those auditory tones is actually aligned with sort of higher meditative states of the brain. I've looked at some of the research on this, and it looks like there is some research showing that it might actually work. We call this brain entrainment. But what it actually does do, it's a powerful activator of the parasympathetic system. So there's a lot of very expensive ways to get BNBs. There's online programs where you can buy DVDs. This app is one I really like. It's called Brainwave Studio. It's a really good way to focus, and they've got a great interface with a lot of different background sounds and music, and they've got specific apps to help you focus at work, and I actually use it sometimes at work when I'm sort of having trouble concentrating, or they've got some great nighttime relaxation sounds to get you in different frequencies as well. So it's a cool tool I've used with patients, and I found it pretty helpful, so maybe check that out if you're having trouble with some of the other tools. Now, I want to get down to numbers here, because I know a lot of things that we've talked about today are kind of abstract, and I know I've got a lot of lab numbers up here, but what I want to show you is a couple of things I want to highlight. So this is a typical patient I see in my clinic, somebody who's got high cholesterol, and we implemented a lot of the strategies that Dr. Keel talked about, really how can we intensify and improve the diet, the triglycerides got better, but I want you to look at another number here, which is a C-reactive protein, or the CRP. That is a number, it's a marker for inflammation, and you can see that this gentleman's inflammation levels were at 10.6, really high. We did some dietary changes, and we actually dropped it to 3.6. 3.6 is still relatively high, but I wanted to tell you, we went from 3.6 to 0.6 by just implementing one technique and one technique only. Because again, inflammation is a risk factor for heart disease, cancer, and chronic health conditions, and the only intervention we did from 3.6 to 0.6 was meditation. That was it. Just implemented stress reduction, nothing else changed, and inflammation was dropped down. I see this over and over. There are plenty of studies now out there to show the impact of stress reduction on inflammation, on gut health, all these factors. So just wanted to give you some quantified evidence of what we see in the clinic all the time. Okay? So here's another frustration. I'm very jealous because I sleep on a $1,000 mattress in a temperature-controlled room. I wear eye shades, and still I struggle to sleep. And then this guy basically is limp in deep phase sleep on a rickety rickshaw. It's just not fair. And really, the issue here is basically, unlike the rickshaw driver here, his body is so physically tired. His physical activity is always going to overpower his mental activity, right? His body's exhausted. We're exactly the opposite. We sit all day, our bodies are underworked, but our minds are overworked, and that imbalance leads to a lot of sleep issues, okay? So a couple of tools I wanna talk about. This is one of my favorite devices, and unfortunately the company went out of business, but hopefully they're gonna be picked up and rebuilt somewhere else. But this was a sleep tool called the MyZio device. An alarm clock with a headband sensor, and unlike Fitbit and motion-sensitive devices, this actually measured the phases of sleep. It would pick up some EEG data. And so it would tell me how much deep phase sleep I'm getting, because there's different stages of sleep, and deep phase sleep is really the metabolically healthy sleep. So I'm just showing you some of my own personal data. So this was a day where I didn't exercise, my stress levels were high. Unfortunately, I'm very sensitive to alcohol. I did have a glass of wine. And my sleep data, you can see I slept about 6 hours and 40 minutes, but my deep phase sleep was about 1 hour and 5 minutes. Okay, so fast forward to this day where I exercised at 3 p.m., warm bath and no alcohol, my sleep hours went up to 8 hours and 14 minutes, and I got 1 hour extra deep phase sleep. Even a few minutes of extra deep phase sleep is powerful, but deep phase sleep makes you feel alive when you wake up. It promotes more growth hormone, lots of great metabolic changes. But I don't use this tool anymore. The data already kind of made the case to me, and so now I've really had to make, you know, powerful lifestyle interventions to really help with that. Another thing I want to teach you about sleep is that first burst of growth hormone comes roughly between 10 p.m. and 2 a.m. So if you're habitually going to bed at 12 or 1, you're missing out on that. When I've seen the studies on this, for me, my late nights are my early mornings. I'd rather go to bed at 9:30, and if I have work to do, I'll get up at 4 or 4:30 to do that. If I'm watching TV, I watch Netflix at 4 in the morning, because I'm not going to miss my growth hormone, okay? That's the way to get it, so really keep that in mind. Okay? So really what I tell docs nowadays is MDVs are modern day vital signs. Just like we check blood pressure, pulse, and temperature, we gotta check things like walking steps. We gotta keep track of sleep duration, stress levels, the nutrient density that Dr. Akhil made such a powerful case for, the carbohydrate intake, whatever macronutrients, but these are really the types of vital signs we need to start following. Okay? And really, today's doctor, you know, my goal, I'm kind of rewarded because nowadays I prescribe more apps than I do medications, right? I'd rather send people to the grocery store than the drugstore. And I think that's really the approach we're looking for here. How can we use other powerful lifestyle intervention tools and use medication as a last line of defense when we implement these? Okay? So now I'm going to give you the ultimate wellness investment. Okay, there's something that I purchased 6 months ago that actually has increased my vitamin D levels, my walking steps, it's lowered my stress levels, and it's improved my gut microbiome. Has anybody invested in this? I just want to hear any guesses. Yes, you got it. It's Riley, okay? So I want to tell you, that was awesome. I got the dog app, okay? It's on the App Store, I got this. My wife and I are the last people on earth that would ever get a dog, but our twins finally convinced us. And this is me, actually. I was meditating outside. I was sitting, and he will come to my feet, actually, while I meditate. So I look down, he's looking right up at me. It's, like, wonderful. It's, like, so you know, definitely studies have shown more oxytocin, you know, the bonding hormone, and wonderful things. And this, really, I put up here more to say that often we attach labels to ourselves, and I always call myself a non-dog person. But after we went through this, it was just a very powerful investment for, really, our family health. Okay, so lastly, I want to end with just a few kind of bigger picture concepts. So the Silicon Valley syndrome, this really intense pace of life, these seeds are planted really early in life because we're starting to see a lot of these conditions manifest in our kids, right? We have a distorted belief system based on a lot of slogans like survival of the fittest. That works when your lifespan is 20 and you're in an area with limited resources. Yes, maybe survival of the fittest works then, but many of us sort of carry that throughout our lives with hyper-competitive lifestyles and we end up burning out. A lot of my entrepreneurs that I see are suffering with emotional disorders, marriage problems, depression. You know, there's a lot of issues. They've built their companies, but they haven't really fulfilled their sense of happiness and self-worth. So we have to really change some of the slogans here. The relentless pursuit of perfection. If you haven't read any of Brené Brown's work, it's really powerful work. A lot of doctors in the audience, a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of suffer with this perfectionism attitude where nothing's quite good enough. My kids' cross-country slogan, I just put this slide up here, was never let good enough be enough. And maybe that's a good slogan for sports, but man, that's a dangerous slogan to carry around in your life when you never feel like what you're doing is really good enough. So really, we got to change some of the language. We can definitely still drive success without really creating thought patterns that really drive mental health issues too. Okay? And so this just distorted beliefs, I think a lot of us are very protocol-driven. We think a higher education, a great job is going to lead to bliss. Maybe if I start my own company, it's going to lead to bliss. For me, even when I was having some career crises, I thought that, you know what, writing a book, that's going to get me there. And writing a book has been a very rewarding process for me, but it definitely hasn't created bliss. On my career, what I've realized is that, you know, you can change your career, you can change your profession, but what really brings you happiness is the daily things we've been talking about. When you're getting exposed to nature, when you develop the social connections, you're getting physical activity, those things have to be entrenched in our kids as well, and we can't be so protocol-driven. Okay? And I put a picture here of my brother, because my brother, he's 8 years older than me. My dad is an MD, PhD, he passed away 10 years ago, and his dream was for my brother to become a doctor. But he's not an artist, by the way, so don't get nervous by that picture. He's a genetic engineer, so he didn't quite go into medical school, but that was a big disappointment for him. And then for me, what happened was, you know, even though people ask me, so why did you become a doctor, Ron? And often I will tell them it's because I wanted to help people. But I'll be honest with you, for me, it was a lot of pressure, because when my brother didn't go into medicine, I felt like I had to carry on that duty. And I'm bringing this example up because I had a patient that I saw in the clinic, and she actually brought in her son, 10-year-old kid, this summer, and she actually had read my book. And she said, you know what, I had my son read your book, and he loved it. And he wants to be a doctor just like you. And I'm like, he's 10 years old. He should be reading Harry Potter. He should not be reading about metabolic syndrome, okay? And then I looked over at the son. I said, really? You really want to be a doctor? And he kind of shrugged his shoulder and said, I guess so, right? So it kind of resonated with me too, because often our kids' dreams are the parents' dreams, right? We're setting the protocol. We're seeing a lot of burnout right now, okay? So we really have to step back and understand, what do our kids need right now? Do they need these protocols, or do they need a lot of the lifestyle interventions that we talked about? We are seeing a lot of mental health issues, you know, stress, depression, anxiety. You know, I sit next to a pediatric endocrinologist when I see patients, and the lab results she's seeing in 7, 8, 9-year-old kids look exactly the same as the 40, 50-year-old adults that I'm seeing. High triglycerides, fatty liver, type 2 diabetes, it's overwhelming amounts of stress. I actually read with mental health, in age 10 to 14, young girls, the suicide rate has tripled since 1999, age 10 to 14. So we've really got to start keeping these things in mind. A lot of our kids are feeling overwhelmed. They're drowning with responsibilities. And, you know, when we think about this, I kind of think of kids, if they're a glass of water, we're throwing on the academics, the extracurriculars, all these intense expectations, but we haven't built any capacity into these kids. The only way they can handle this capacity is basically by getting more rest and sleep, more play and idle time, eating the nutrient-dense foods, not getting rushed from activity to activity, developing the social connections that Dr. Akhil talked about so much, and really spending more time with family. So I hope this is something we can really pass on, because like I said, those seeds start very early in life. And finally, I just want to point out the fact, here's me strapped to all these devices, but my grandmother didn't need any of these apps or devices. She lived to be 86. She knew when it was good to be out in the sun. She could deadlift drugs of water at age 80. Her brain function was fine. So really our goal, both of our goals, is really to connect you to some of those ancestral roots. Use technology when you need to move that pendulum back to the middle, and really try to make this a habit for everyone in the family. Okay, so my resources, I blog there, my books over there as well. I do see patients at Palo Alto Medical Foundation. It's been an honor to be here, and we look forward to answering your questions. Thanks very much.